Hello, animal friends. Hope everyone's doing well. I know it's still blazing hot in some parts of the country, so I hope your furry, feathered, fin, scaled family members, as well as yourselves, are finding ways to stay well hydrated and to keep cool. Today, I want to talk to you about whether you're moving down the street, maybe to the next state, or clear across country like I recently did. It's so important, and you can really make the transition a whole lot easier for all of your furry, feathered, scaled, and fin family members if you do some planning and research ahead of time. Last summer, as many of you know, my family decided to move from the West Coast to the East Coast. And although we were very excited about it, of course, you know, there was a lot of stress involved. They say moving is one of those things, kind of like getting married or divorce or losing a loved one, that it really does wreak havoc with the body. And, you know, everybody needs to take care of themselves so that they can take care of everybody else. Sorry, my son's making all kinds of noises over here today. But as much as we made this decision to go, I don't think Haiku really had it on his radar. He had pretty much spent his whole life with us in the same house. He was one of the few dogs we got as a puppy, you know, since my hearts was seniors, I'm always adopting seniors. But at that point in time, Cheryl, I'm glad you made it. At that point in time, I had recently lost three seniors just because they were older. So the rescue I was volunteering with said, you need to foster this puppy. And foster failure. But I think they knew that was going to be the plan for all along. And, you know, that's how Haiku, who's now 13, has been with us all this time. But so basically he lived in that one house with us in California his whole life until we uprooted him last year and took him clear across country. So there was a lot I needed to think about ahead of time. And that's what I want to start sharing with you today. I'm going to talk about on the move with your best friend, the months prior, and then embarking on that journey. And for those of you that do live in Southern California, the latest edition of the Pet Press, the June, July, and August 2018 issue, with this nice cover story by about my friend Marty Becker, written by yours truly, there's an article inside here where it was first printed, but you, those of you that aren't in California, you can actually go to my blog after this broadcast is over. I'll make sure I post the link here so you can read all of the tips if any of you are considering a move that you might want to consider for your best friend. But these are just good things to think about. And those of us in the animal world, even if we aren't considering a move, we talk to animal people all over, and it's just always something you can share with someone and hopefully set them on the right path. Barbara, nice to see you too today. So what I want you to start thinking about is research. And like I said, even if you aren't moving, some of this is just really fascinating, and it'll show you that we really need to affect changes someplace. Learn where you're going, how many pets are allowed, where you have to register them, and all of that kind of information. In Los Angeles, where I had been, if you don't have a kennel license, you could have four dogs or four cats or a combination thereof. The city, an incorporated city right in LA County, Burbank, where I spent a lot of my time volunteering and hanging out and doing things with friends, had an ordinance for three. So any combination of dogs and cats up to three was allowed. In my new town, the sky is the limit. I came here, you know, and right away wanted to know how many dogs I can have, where I have to register Haiku. And everybody was like laughing at me, register your dog? How many dogs? As many as you want. So things really do vary around the country, and it's important to know. Hey, Jen, nice to see you today. So, you know, those are some of the things you're going to want to know right hand, because if you're moving to a city that allows three dogs and you already have four, two dogs and two cats, you may want to try to move outside that city perimeter so that you'll be within the ordinances and won't risk any confiscation of your pets. You're going to also want to find out about breed restrictions. And I know so many of us don't actually even think about that because we don't think that really exists or should exist. But let me tell you, it does. I know I'm going back quite a few years now, but during Katrina, when a lot of the dogs were being transported from the East Coast to the West Coast. Actually, it wasn't even Katrina. It was during the Michael Vick era. A lot of the dogs were being taken to the West Coast, and they had to be very careful because if they let a pit bull out, even for a potty break in certain cities, that dog could have been confiscated and most likely euthanized because pit bulls are not allowed. Their breed restrictions in quite a number of cities. 36 cities actually in Michigan have dog breed bans or legislation. 62 cities in Wisconsin, 30 in Arizona, 90 in Ohio, and that's just scratching the surface. There are tons more. Some are actual bans that a certain breed of dog is not allowed, and it isn't always pit bulls. Sometimes it's German Shepherds and Akitas and Rottweilers and Dobermans, Great Danes. A lot of, you know, just larger dogs are sometimes banned. There are also a lot of restrictions you need to know about in the different cities. Because sometimes they require spay neuter. Sometimes a dog has to be on a leash. Sometimes a dog, you know, there's so many crazy restrictions that it's just so important you do your research about where you're going to land, because you may not want to live in the city you originally intended. You may want to live on the outskirts, just outside of it. And you also need to know about any cities you're traveling through if you're going to be driving like we did across country, because trust me, Haiku needed potty breaks along the way, and we needed to stretch our legs, and you know, that could have been a concern. So those are some of the things to start researching. Then also there's vaccinations, health concerns, and quarantine. Generally, if we're driving in the continental U.S. or even flying, there aren't really quarantines to worry about. But in Hawaii, that can be an issue. You have to start the blood testing and get your pet health evaluated, I think about 6 months before you actually leave. If you're going to various countries, that can, you know, be at least as long or even longer. The thing with Hawaii is they don't have any rabies on the island. I think they don't even have squirrels, so any of my friends from Hawaii chime in here. But, you know, it's just one of those things that you have to know about, because as much as you object to a rule or an ordinance, there's nothing you're going to do about it when you're in moving with your pet. Obviously, once you're there, if you've researched it ahead of time, you got a bunch of people on your team, you can fight certain things. But when you're, you know, in the process of moving, you're going to have to follow the rules. Haiku grew up in California, where his core vaccinations were DHPP, the 4-in-1 vaccine, distemper, hepatitis, parainfluenza, and parvovirus. He also always got bordetella and rabies vaccines, and we would check titers. But where I was going, to the southeast, it's a lot wetter, and leptospirosis is a concern. So I needed to start that process because he needed a shot and a booster prior to we left, because it took time, you know, for it actually to take hold and take effect. And I know, you know, knew this by reading up. I also did an interesting exercise in that I, you know, asked some people for some vet recommendations in the area where we were going to be moving to. And I emailed a lot of these vets. Gosh, I never know on this camera which way I'm going. It's like looking in a mirror, or it's not looking in a mirror. I emailed some of these veterinarians ahead of time and asked them some questions, kind of that I already knew the answer to, but was grilling them about leptospirosis. And the feedback I got from the veterinarians was very interesting. Some didn't want to respond to me at all if I wasn't a patient. Some gave me some good information, but up to a point, saying, you know, that they would need to see the dog. Some never even returned an email. So that also, besides giving me additional information, gave me insight into some of the veterinary offices where I was going to be living. And the person that gave me the best answer, most courteous, most full answer, actually turned out to be the closest, believe it or not, and turned out to be Haiku's new vet, and I couldn't be happier with them. So it doesn't always work out that way, but, you know, if I got an email that was kind of, you know, curt and not informative, you know, it was like, well, I don't need to try that office. I would try somewhere else. So that was just kind of an interesting exercise as well. But do know that about vaccinations, things may vary from different parts of the country. I'm learning so much more about heartworm than I ever knew. Heartworm was one of those things that as a child, I saw a picture in a book. I grew up with a great dame named Ulysses, and my parents had an old book. It was probably from the 50s. I'll never forget opening it, and there was a black and white picture of a dog's heart that was infested with heartworms, and it was just a horrible thing to see, and it always made an impact. But in California, it wasn't a huge deal. We did keep our dogs on preventives because there would be the occasional mosquito around, but it was rare that you'd hear about it. That is changing, California friends. Again, for the same reasons that a lot of dogs have been transported from the East Coast to the West Coast, they've brought diseases, the climate has been changing, people are landscaping, there's a lot of wetness in the dry areas now. So heartworm is prevalent pretty much throughout the country. But and I know I've done a video on this before, so go back in the archives, but it's relatively easy and inexpensive to prevent. But it's costly and it's difficult to treat. Dogs have to go through the imidacide injections, and they basically have to lie still for 6 months while the heartworms are shed throughout their body. I know I'm all over the map today, but I'm just trying to tell you all different things you need to keep in mind if you're thinking about, you know, moving the location from where you currently habitate or cohabitate with animal friends in your life. So do think about vaccinations, what health concerns might be there, if there's a need for quarantine. One of the things I was happy to leave behind in California were the rattlesnakes, because with the drought that was going on, I was seeing rattlesnakes in our yard every year. And many of you know that my lady bonsai had gotten bitten one time. Fortunately, I knew what to do, and my fabulous vet, Dr. Liz Koskimaki, took really good care of her, nursed her back to health, but it was just always a fear. And there were times I would have to call some of the local reptile rescues to come and actually remove the rattlesnake from under my office in the backyard. So I don't miss that. But, you know, every place has its own inherent dangers, and we have coral snakes out here. Copperheads. So, you know, you need to know what's indigenous to the area and what's indigenous to where you're going to be moving to. It's really important to keep an eye on it, because remember, when you have a dog or a cat, you have a furry toddler for life. You need to think about the mode of transportation you're going to take. We decided we were going to drive. We wanted to go cross country. We wanted to drag our stuff in a vehicle behind us, and that made it easier for Haiku to be with us every step of the way. But that meant we had to plan to make sure, and he always had, you know, a harness and a seat belt, so that wasn't anything new. He was used to that. But if you have a pet that isn't, that's something you're going to have to acclimate him to. If you have a pet that isn't used to long car rides, you need to start working on that the months ahead of time, because if your dog goes in the car all the time, but he goes just, you know, 3 blocks away to the dog park, that's a whole lot different than driving 8, you know, hours a day for 3, 4, 5 days in the car. So it's important to acclimate him. Make sure you have all of his gear in the car, meaning his water, his bed, or a way for him to be comfy, you know, snacks, first aid kit, of course, and especially some of those ginger snap cookies in case he gets an upset tummy along the way. If you're choosing another mode of transportation, you need to research that ahead of time. Flying and pets just isn't for me personally. I just can't imagine I'm going to have a situation where I'd have to do that. I know some people have to do that sometimes, and sometimes we have to fly pets to get them to different parts of the country so that they can be adopted. So I'm not all out saying no to it, but all you have to do is have turned on the news over the last few months and know some terrible things can happen on a plane. But of course, terrible things can happen to humans too. But if you are planning a plane trip with a pet, try to plan it during the time of year where the weather's more agreeable, where it's not so hot or not so cold, because there are delays and the animals can get left on those luggage racks on the tarmac in the heat or the cold. They'll be under the plane more. Temperatures will just be hotter or colder because they're less regulated. If you have a smaller pet, you might be lucky enough to bring them on board, but they're going to have to be quiet. You know, and their little carriers under the seat. And I'm sure the vibrations just must even, you know, be unsettling to them. Hey, Scott, I just saw you were here too. Nice to see you. If you are moving pets through the airport, getting a baggage cart could truly save your back, especially if you have a big cat, a big carrier. If you have a smaller pet, it's even a good idea because if we're just carrying through the airport a smaller carrier by the handle, that animal's swinging, you know, and that can't be the most fun unless he's really, like some people, into the roller coaster kind of things. You're going to have to attach a health certificate in a manner that it can't be chewed off by the pet. You know, he needs his name on his tag and on his carrier, a number and address of his destination where you're going, cell phone numbers, and an alternate person to contact. So many things to think about. But, you know, having that health certificate is so important. So you're going to want to get that vet check before you go, whether it's by ground, by air, by sea. You need to get that checkup, and it's a smart thing just to make sure your pet is healthy because he's going to be going through stress and so are you. Even if you discuss this with your veterinarian, you've been getting additional vaccines or titer tests, and this has been going on for many months, a couple of weeks before you actually depart, it's really a good idea to get that one more vet check and just see how he's doing because you have been probably exhibiting a whole heap of a lot of stress over the last several weeks. And the pets are going to be experiencing stress too because they can tell their world is being turned over. Things are going in boxes. Very often cats and dogs, when they see suitcases and boxes coming out, it just kind of wigs them out to begin with. Not to mention the additional energy we're exuding from all the stress because is the house going to close on time or, you know, am I going to pass this inspection and all those kind of things that are happening. So, you know, failing to plan for these kind of things for your best friend is really planning to fail for him as well. So just, you know, cross every T, dot every I, make sure you've done your research. Like I said, practice the longer car rides, make sure you have a first aid kit on board. With his health certificate along with the first aid kit, what I actually did for Haiku was laminate the health certificate because I could tell I was going to have it folded up in my purse or in the glove compartment. And, you know, if I needed to pull it out at a hotel all the time or, you know, should somebody stop us and inquire about him, I just thought that was an easy way to find it. It was stiff. It wasn't going to get wet if I spilled a drink in the car or dropped the pizza on it or something if we were eating along the way. So that worked really well for me. I had those ginger snap cookies. And we brought a lot of bottled water. Reason for that is water changes everywhere from city to state, and we were going from the West Coast to the East Coast down south. It wasn't like that now, but I'll never forget when I first left Florida and my first trip from Florida to California, my dad and I drove and we were in Mississippi and we could smell the water coming out of the faucet there. You know, so had we consumed it, I'm sure we would have had dysentery for a few days. Not that there was maybe anything wrong with that water, but it was something our bodies weren't used to. So we certainly brought plenty of water and also of Haiku's meals because you just never know if you're going to be able to find that same type of dog food or cat food along the route you're taking. And when you're already, you know, got creating chaos, the last thing you want to do is change your pet's diet. So those were some of the things I wanted you to think about as you're embarking on the trip. Also, ID tags. Get a new ID tag. Make sure it has your cell phone number on it. But if there's somebody, if you already know your new address, great. But if there's also somebody in your new location that you can have as a second phone number, that could be really helpful. Sure, when you get settled, you're going to get another set of ID tags. But the idea is that you don't want the tag on the dog that is from his old address and neighborhood. Update the microchip information as soon as possible because, you know, that is one way that pets that go missing get reconnected with their humans. So make sure at the very least that the cell phone you're taking on your move is connected to the microchip so that, you know, should the worst happen, you know, you can be reconnected. And that also brings me to what I always talk about in disaster preparedness. Have a good, clear picture of your pet with you on your phone, a printout. So if the worst happens, even if he just escapes the hotel room, you have a picture of him to create flyers right away, to show people, to make sure you can be reunited with your best buddy. One of the most important things, though, I can say about the whole moving process is, as best as you can, stick to a schedule. Their life is in turmoil, your life is in turmoil. It's just like around the holidays. Don't, you know, change up the time you go for a walk, or that the dog gets the potty break, or the time you feed the kitty. Stick to it as much as possible. Things are going to have to be a little fluid, and, you know, it depends on what time you actually pull into a pet-friendly hotel that night. But, and that's what we're going to talk about in the next issue, in my next broadcast, because pet friendly doesn't mean the same thing to every hotel. So I will definitely talk to you about that next time. But I just wanted to leave you with doing the best to control your own stress levels, because animals are so receptive. They pick up on our emotions. Bring along the things you need. There could be an accident in the hotel room. Make sure you have that enzymatic cleaner so that you can clean it up. Bring the pet's own bedding. Don't, you know, get cross with him because you're going to be cranky. It's not going to help the situation at all, and it's going to make you feel bad afterwards that you've yelled at your precious pooch. So the message of today is, whether you're moving across the street to the next city, next state, or across the country, or even out of the country, research and planning is so very important. It's your obligation to your pet to make sure that transition goes smoothly. So I hope most of you are staying put, but if you're embarking on a new adventure, four paws up, because it can be a great thing. We're really happy we've made this transition and are enjoying our new place in the world, still getting acclimated to it. I look forward to seeing you next time, where we're going to actually talk about what to do when you get to that new location, when you're finding that new home, and the stuff you need to be looking for in transitioning your pet into that new lifestyle. So have an awesome possum week, everybody. It's almost the weekend. Enjoy, stay cool, stay well hydrated, and give special belly rubs and ear scratches from me. Bye-bye for now.